Now let's dive into fuel orientation control algorithms for brushless motor. As you can see from this overview system level block diagram, we differentiate the control algorithm and physical system by colors. From the control side, there are many components such as park clock transformation to convert current and voltage between stationary reference frame and synchronized reference frame. On the outer loop, we have speed controller and inner loop current controller. To do closed-loop control, we also have position or speed as a feedback from either sensor decoding logic or box observer for those of you who are interested in sensorless control. To make the presentation more interesting, now instead of showing you the implementation of fuel orientation control, I would like to show you how do we design maximum torque per ampere MTPA with fuel weakening control. So now the output of speed control and the input of the current controller is embedded with MTPA and fuel weakening. In this case, the current reference of Q and D axis are calculated based on NTPA and fuel weakening algorithms to achieve maximum torque and minimum losses. So let's quickly refresh back what's fuel weakening control on brushless motors. What does it mean, and what's the motivation of doing that? Typically, in FOC, we run the motor within a limit of base speed. But for some application, we like to run motor beyond the base speed, where the back EMF will increase and it's more than supply voltage. So the idea of fuel weakening control is to help us achieve higher speed without hitting the DC bus voltage. So we manipulate the D-axis stator current to be a negative value, which means we reduce the fuel current so that applied stator magnetic field is in the opposite direction to the rotor magnetic field. Turns out the resulting magnetic field is reduced. Now the back EMF is reduced, so does reduce rotor flux linkage, which allows the motor to run above the base speed. Another aspect to achieve maximum torque per ampere MTPA is to increase the efficiency of the machine and to minimize the stator current losses, as shown in here on the right side of the figure. The blue concave curve shows the constant torque line indicating all the IQ and ID pair force on those lines produce the same amount of torque, but only constant torque line intersect with the MTPA lines are the operating points that can achieve MTPA. So now we have an accurate plane model and are ready to design our controller. We will start with putting together a fuel orientation control algorithms with MTPA and fuel weakening capability, including sensor decoder or observers if you want to implement sensorless control. So let's take a look through our model. Here we have our speed controller that compute IQ and ID reference to track desired speed. One thing to notice that the fuel weakening and MTPA control reference has been implemented here. The torque and speed reference are input variables. The output IQ and ID are calculated based on MTPA trajectory to produce desired optimum torque with minimum current magnitude. Also, as we look closer, we can enable or disable the fuel weakening control depends on the operating speed condition. Now we are navigate to close loop fuel orientation current control system. We have clock, plug transformation, space vector generator, and as we dive into the IQ and ID PI regulator, we can see a fuel weakening control is implemented to control the ID reference. Remember, we have to inject a negative current to reduce the back EMF voltage. Next, I will navigate to a subsystem that does sensor processing for current and position measurement. In the position measurement, you can see how we decode quadrature encoder readings using blocks from Motor Control Blockset. And here, I'm showing you how we computed duty cycles are written to PWM drivers on the microcontroller. Here, I'm also showing you the inverter and motor plane model so we can run closed loop simulation. Now I would like to show you the workflow how to tune the loop gains of current and speed controller. One thing to notice is that all shipping demos from Motor Control Blockset, including the one here, come with the scripts that run automatically when the motor initialized before simulation or code generation. As shown in the script here, we are setting up our sample rate, loading the estimated motor parameters, and computed offset for the sensors. So after the parameter has been set up, we can use the provided utility that will automatically compute all the loop gains based on motor and inverter parameter values. The script uses computed gains and motor parameter values to automatically compute gains and phase margin for our current loop and plot loop locus, body plot, and step response by using the control system toolbox. And in the workspace here, you can see we have our estimate motor parameters, sensor offset, and computed loop gains. So for the tuning of loop gains, Motor Control Blockset not only have empirical calculation, but also FWC auto tuner can automatically compute loop gains based on the bandwidth and phase margin you specify. You can also use other tools from Simulink control design to tune control gains. So let's move on, run our control algorithm in closed loop simulation. As you can see from the top left corner, we can simulate the plant model with switching event by choosing Syncscape Electrical, then comparing with the simulation result using average value inverter model. Once the simulation is over, we can look at the result in Data Inspector. So we are going to look at the speed response, IQ response, phase A voltage and current, and finally pulse width modulation waveform. As you can see on the speed command tracking, on the first one, it looks pretty good with the speed feedback follow the speed command. And let's look at the second row of the current command tracking response. We can see the switching effect where highlighted in yellow and the blue light shows the current is modeled by average value inverter. While we zoom in, we can clearly see the effect of switching in the phase voltage and current plot. And finally, when we look at the PWM modulation waveform, there's not a big significant difference between those two rounds, but the bottom line is that we can run different levels of stability depends on our test scenario. As we zoom in here, we can clearly see the effect of switching events.